teleology goes beyond that and says, no, beyond the purposes we give ourselves, there are real purposes out there in the universe, whether you acknowledge it or not. Even if you don't accept it as your purpose, it really is your purpose. That's really why you were born. And of course, that leads to the Creator, because who has the authority to give such purposes? It's funny, because in our age, religious history in the West, especially in Europe, has been so traumatic. It was so traumatic, and we all know the list of horrors. And the interesting thing is, if you actually go and read the detailed history, it's much worse than you thought. So, I mean, you know what post-traumatic stress disorder is. And post-traumatic stress disorder can affect not only individuals, it can affect society, and it can affect historical civilizations. And what we are seeing now is large numbers of people in the Western world who are suffering on a civilization level from post-traumatic stress disorder. And the symptoms, you know, the prime symptoms of PTSD are, for example, hypervigilance, because the nervous system doesn't want to be shocked again. And you can see how this is transmitted from generation to generation. For example, let's say birds. You can notice that there are certain places, parks, where humans never harm birds, and the birds just treat humans like, you know, they're not afraid of anything, and they'll just walk right past you. And there are other places where the birds, you know, they're very skittish, and they'll immediately try to get away from you, or animals. And of course, this is passed on because, let's say, a little birdlet. A little bird is just, you know, still under its mother's care, and the mother, you know, gets very scared by something, and the little bird learns that behavior. And so you can actually have societal PTSD or all these things. And so the hypervigilance withdrawal, like, we don't want to be shocked again. So, for example, because of religious fanaticism, there's huge numbers of people in this country, almost most people, who are, you could say, hyper-vigilant about absolute truth claims. So if someone says, this is the highest truth, oh my God, Middle Ages, all over again, Inquisitions, Crusades, burning people alive at the stake, and all the person said is that I believe this is the highest truth. So it's a type of hype, and so in a sense, in many circles in the West, people have lost their ability to engage in critical discussion of spiritual claims, but with mutual respect. In other words, no one's going to kill anyone, no one's going to say, you worship a dead God, I worship a living God, or you have a false religion, I have a... I mean, no one's going to engage in a toxic speech. It's a discussion among people, and actually, think of any field at all in life, if we outlaw critical discussion, I mean, you know, well-intentioned critical discussion, quality control goes to hell. And so when you have large communities of people who are spiritual seekers, but it's like worst possible faux pas, you know, the worst problem is the worst manners possible, like, my God, if that works for you, that's your truth. And no one even bothers to think what that means, like, I own the truth. Does that mean there are, like, infinite parallel universes? Or so philosophy has been reduced down to psychology in the sense that if someone says, this is my truth, and if they're polite and, you know, 21st century, they won't say, this is the truth. They'll say, this is my truth. And then, what does that mean? So it just, what they mean when they say this is my truth is, it makes me happy or it makes me feel good. So if someone says this is my truth, they're actually not making a philosophical claim, they're making a psychological claim. And since everyone has, as philosophers would say, everyone has a privileged awareness of their own inner states. Everyone, you know, because you know about your inner states better than anyone else. Therefore, no one can deny anyone else's truth claim. Like, this is my truth. Because, like, how can someone else tell you it doesn't make you feel good? And you're not really talking about truth in the old-fashioned sense of the word, the objective state of the world. You're just giving a report about your feelings. And the sense that there even is such a thing as objective knowledge, which is not really another way of saying my personal feelings, is considered to be, like, I don't know, fanatical, or what are you doing? Rude. say something's true, someone else may not agree, and it may affect your self-esteem. So we live in an age when, therefore, thinking has become so sloppy and so silly because there's no critical thinking. Imagine your field. Imagine it's like, let's say, if you're a pharmacist, or if you're a lawyer, or if you're a doctor, or if you're a poet, or just where there's no refereed journals, there's no critical thinking. Anything anyone says in your field is as good as anything anyone else says in your field. Imagine it's physical fitness. I mean, it's just going to be complete chaos and mediocrity.
Which kind of feels like what it, I mean, with the internet, that's kind of what happens, is you can go out and find anything to support anything you want to believe, no matter how wacko it might sound.
Yeah.
Whether it's in the physical or metaphysical or what have you.
Yeah, yeah. So if you think about it, the democratization of knowledge is now everyone. You don't earn your way into a journal or even speak. I mean, just like you can point and click or type something, and you're equal authority with anyone else. And so